that is proper positioning. Once the disease pathology has come down, usually after 2 to 3 months, what we do is we try to mobilize the joint. Otherwise, what happens if you don't mobilize, it goes into more stiffness, that is mobilization part. Once you have started mobilization, the muscles, I told you, becomes more atrophied, more specifically in tuberculosis, because it's a chronic pathology when compared to septic arthritis. So in tuberculosis, once you started mobilizing the joint, you have to strengthen those muscles too. Okay, that is the exercise. And once the patient is good enough to mobilize himself and exercise, then start weight bearing. Okay. Now, what are all the operative, this is all general about tuberculosis. What are all the operative interventions that you do in tuberculosis? Is one, you do a biopsy to diagnose. Second is cold abscess, drain it. Third is curettage of the lesion to get rid of the lesion. Fourth is debridement of a joint, take out all the necrosis from the joint. I told you synovitis plays an important role to harbor the tuberculosis bacilli. If at all you have a tuberculosis, today we have done one case, right? So suspecting it to be tuberculosis. So if at all you have a suspicion of a tuberculosis and synovium is harboring, remove that synovium. So subtotal synovectomy can be done. Synovectomy can be done in cases where the tuberculosis is not amenable for your treatment, even with these drugs, even after doing arthrocentesis and instilling some antibiotics, giving oral antibiotics, it's not going, do synovectomy. Sometimes the joint is totally gone, but patient wants movement. There, no, not patient doesn't want ankylosis or arthrodesis, right? Hence, we have to resolve to some certain procedures wherein there is still movement possible. Hence, we have to remove the joint. That means it's a salvage operation, especially when it comes to hip joint. We cut the head and neck, remove it, throw it out. That's called girdle stone resection arthroplasty. That's a surgical option. Still, you can use it in hip joint. Next is decompression. I told you, decompression works very good when it comes to the bony part of it. Same thing, if at all there is a tuberculosis of the spine, now these all nonsense, pus, granulation tissue, bony sequestrae, or the deformity is going and pressing on the cord, you have cord symptoms. So now you have to decompress the compression on the cord, hence it is called as decompression surgery. You do by various means, either you do anterolateral decompression by removing some part of the vertebra as well as transverse process, or just remove the transverse process and some amount of the rib, it's called costotransversectomy. You decompress, or you go from back, remove the lamina and take out the pus and all the granulation tissue within the spinal canal, that's also called as decompression. If you don't do that, ultimately you will have pressure on the spinal cord will nicely sleep, it will not function properly, and you will also have to sleep for the whole of your lifetime, right? Sleep means not that, you have to lie down on the bed, paraplegic. Now, having learnt specifically, non-specifically about what tuberculosis is and about all the other components of tuberculosis, let us go into a specific part of tuberculosis, tuberculosis of the spine. It is called as Pott's disease of spine also, or some usually called as Pott's spine. Just see this, the tuberculosis has eaten away the vertebra, this is the vertebra, this is the disc, eaten away the vertebra, more specifically anteriorly, and once there is a wedging, there is a posterior bulge, and this is a cord being compressed badly there. Now once there is a cord compression, you will have cord symptoms, right? Once you have eaten away of eating, once the vertebra has got damaged, so now this is not going to support the pillar which has to support the spine which is above is not there. Now the building becomes weak, so there is an instability factor also, okay? All these things, they come in tuberculosis of the spine. Now I told you, spine is the most commonest organ to be affected. 50% of the tuberculosis patients of bone and joint tuberculosis will be spinal tuberculosis. I told you where it comes down from, and within the spine also, dorsal spine plays the major contributing factor to the tuberculosis. So dorsal tuberculosis is more common, and when it comes down more specifically, this is a bit actually. Tuberculosis paradiscal is the most commonest affection, and more specifically anteriorly, anterior paradiscal, and second is anterior, third is central, and last is posterior. Posterior means it can be in the pedicle or in the transverse process or in the spinous process. This is a transverse process, this is a spinous process. This is paradiscal, this is central, this is anterior. Okay. Now when it comes down to pathology, I told you the pathology is same everywhere. Tubercular osteomyelitis, granulation tissue, pus formation, and ultimately, if you have only the bony lesion, you have a problem with the bone. If the bone is destroyed, what will happen? You will have a collapse of the bone. Now, if one vertebra has collapsed, collapse means it bends forward. The forward bending is called as kyphosis. So if one vertebra or two vertebra have bent forward, or there is a collapse like this, you call it as What is this? What is this? Knuckle. It is called as knuckle kyphus. Take these words. There is a lot of confusion in the literature. Kyphosis, kyphus is a common term we use for forward bending of the spine. This usually happens because of the damage that happens to the vertebra, more specifically on the anterior side, right? And hence it bends down like this, forward bending. If it happens in one or two vertebra, you call it as knuckle kyphus. If it is happening more than one or two, is kyphus, right? Anything more than two, till five vertebra, you call it as angular deformity. It is there in Tully. I am just giving it as it is. 3, 4, 5 vertebra, it is angular. Anything more than 5, you have a rounded deformity. It is called as rounded kyphus, also called as gibbous. Now this gibbous has been interchangeably used right from one vertebra also. Some people use gibbous even if there is a collapse of one vertebra leading to a deformity, which we call it as knuckle kyphus. 1 or 2 knuckle kyphus, 3, 4, 5 angular, okay, more than 5 gibbous. If it is more than 5, usually have a rounded contour, you call it as gibbous. That this has been given in Tully, I am just giving it to you, okay. So I told you the pathology is granulation tissue, pus formation. This pus can go anywhere, track along the tracks. Sometimes if it is there at the level of D10 vertebra, now at the level of D10 vertebra this pus has formed. The D10 vertebra gives one set of fibers which contribute to the psoas muscle. Anteriorly, psoas muscle starts from the anterolateral portion of the vertebral body. It is encased by a sheath. If now there is a granulation tissue and pus formation there, which we call it as cold abscess, if this cold abscess ends up in a psoas sheath, we call it as psoas abscess. This psoas abscess can present to you either posteriorly in the petit triangle or in the groin. Sometimes the pathology is in the spine, but the cold abscess, the swelling, what you see usually will be in the groin or anterior to the hip joint. Most often patient will come with the swelling in the anterior aspect of the hip joint, but if you aspirate and see, it will be pus. You might be feeling that this pus may be coming from the hip joint. No, it may be coming from a D10 vertebra high up. It's a cold abscess coming tracking down. It so happens so many times. Suppose say it is in the cervical spine, it may be tracking down into the hand also. Along the nose, it will go and just track at some other place. So you should always know at what portion. Sometimes in the high up in the ribs, right? The damage is there in the dorsal vertebra. There is a cold abscess formed. This tracks along the intercostal nerve. It can come and present in the axilla, or it sometimes can come and present in the anterior aspect of the chest wall. You may be seeing this tumor or lesion or collection of pus anteriorly. The pathology is there posteriorly. Should know all the sites of cold abscess. And what are all the clinical features with these patients come to you? They come most often with the constitutional symptoms, as I have explained. Pain, stiffness are the most important, commonest symptoms they come with. Back pain. There are 2000 causes for back pain, if at all somebody can enunciate multiple combinations and permutations and combinations. Then how do you identify? Can you label every patient as tuberculosis? No. So you should always have a high index of suspicion with all those constitutional symptoms. Specifically examine those patients, take radiographs, if at all you want, you take the help of serology and all those things, then conclude. So every backache patient, never forget to examine them thoroughly, lest you will miss grave consequences which come from this tuberculosis. So many times it happened. Back pain, what is there? You just leave it. Ultimately it ends up in a collapse of the vertebra, and suddenly patient will come with paraplegia to you. Most often, sometimes they may not even identify this for a long time and ends up in a permanent neurological damage. Okay. Once you examine, there may be localized tenderness, paravertebral spasm. These are the classical features. They will always be there in the spine. There may be kyphotic deformity if there is a collapse of the vertebra. Now, how do you investigate? I already told you all the investigations. Even if you do all the investigations, if you don't have a high index of suspicion, you can still miss. Radiological features are the most important thing you should always remember. When you take a radiograph of the spine, first, most commonest things should come to your mind first. The commonest site of tuberculosis of the spine is paradiscal region. So go and see what is the amount of disc space. If the disc space is reduced significantly, so think of tuberculosis first. Disc space reduced, think of tuberculosis. The earliest thing that happens is the margins of the end plates, the end plate margins will be hazy, right? The disc space is narrowed next. Then there may be a destruction of the vertebral body, there may be an evidence of cold abscess seen as a soft tissue mass, there may be a severe osteopenia, and if you have treated him, there may be signs of healing with sclerosis. This is what you can see. Now you can see the lower aspect of one vertebra and the upper aspect of another vertebra are damaged. That is the paradiscal pathology involving that vertebra as well as this vertebra. Some amount of collapse is there. You see the normal lordosis is lost. Lot of soft tissue swelling is there anteriorly. Prevertebral swelling. This patient has come with an inability to swallow, deglutition, because the pharynx is pushed so anteriorly, he has a problem with deglutation, dysphagia. Now, if you can see, there is a soft tissue mass, right? Because this disc space is gone. If you see the disc space high up and lower down, they are normal. Now, disc space is not there. Whenever you suspect something with regard to disc in the dorsal spine, first rule out tuberculosis, classical, right? So, when it comes down to the pathology of tubercular spine, they have described it in various stages. You might remember, you might not remember, it is called pre-destructive stage, where there is only a muscle spasm. Most often it might be missed. In the early destructive phase, there may be a diminished disc space, and in the stage of destruction, if depending on the number of vertebrae involved, you have various types of pathologies coming in. Less than 30 degrees of kyphosis, more than 32, between 30 to 60 degrees of kyphosis, they all come under stage of destruction. It is divided into three stages, more specifically 4 and 5, they come later on. Right, these are all the stages of vertebral body destruction that you see in tuberculosis. Now, various differential diagnoses are also there, Kahl's disease, Schmall's disease, Schurman's, so many differential diagnoses, but thing is, never ever forget tuberculosis as a differential diagnosis for various other conditions and various other infections, more specifically typhoid and brucella, they can similarly mimic tuberculosis of the spine. Right? What are the complications? I told you the two most important complications are, one is a cold abscess. Cold abscess is a liquefaction and a reactive exudation, lot of pus, debris and leukocytes and lot of tuberculous bacilli. They can take the path of least resistance and can present at any site, and it can be there, okay, it can be anterior, it can be posterior, and sometimes it presents as a bird's nest abscess. Sometimes it presents as a psoas abscess, okay. It can be there in the subcostal margin, come along the ilioinguinal nerve, iliohypocaustic, anywhere. whenever it finds a place where it can travel, it will go and present at that place, okay. On the lateral aspect of the thigh, posterior aspect of the back, right?